LMQ versus Complexity.
And you gotta say, LMQ have been playing incredibly well all split long. They have been in first place for 8 out of the 9 weeks. And to give you an idea of just how good they have been, they have the most kills for a team with 335. Ackerman has the most kills and assists in the top lane. Xiaowei Xiao has the most kills in the mid lane. And Moore has the most assists in the entire league. Every player on this team has actually had their own standout game, so opponents really can't just focus on shutting down one lane either. Ackerman, in particular, though, was very impressive last week on Gragas. His stat line was huge, and he took home the Week 9 MVP award. This is my favorite play of the entire game. Seraph starts off the fight with Ackerman, but he completely outplays him, and he's not done here either. He teleports back to base, buys home guards, uses his teleport to go up top. This is just after killing Seraph. And then he 100% double limp all by himself. Ackerman making plays on both sides of the map within seconds of each other.
It's huge. But if there has been one thing Complexity has excelled at this split, it's taking down top teams and long games, but mostly taking down top teams.
Yeah, as we mentioned at the top of the show, that Complexity is still in that race for a playoff spot. And they can start it off right here with a really big bang. If they were to be able to take down the top team, they could definitely instill that fear of the blue shell in the rest of the league. Last week, we saw Complexity returning to strong laning champions in order to exit that early game without giving up a large advantage to their opponents. And that's going to be especially important against LMQ, who do play aggressive fairly early on.
Very true. Teams like LMQ and Complexity spend hours crafting strategies and honing individual skill. But sometimes winning a game comes to the unseen X factor of game sense.
So you can play the game and you can watch what's going on and you have every like visible aspect covered, but then there's stuff that's going on in your head, working with timings, predicting stuff, and that for me is game sense.
The best example is when you know somebody's in a bush, but you have like no tells. There was like no way to know. You don't have vision in the bush, you don't have vision behind it, you just like know that somebody's there because your spidey sense, your game sense tells you.
It's like deja vu, basically. When I see a scenario, I'm like, I've been here before, I know what to do this time.
Practicing as much as possible, playing actually as much as possible, either solo queue, scrims, even normal games, just gives you so many different situations actually happening that when it actually happens in a real game, like a tournament game, you have that happen before and you'll know what to do.
In the instance that I'm like level 6 is Kog'Maw, I can zone them like infinitely, and if they start playing aggressive at all, you know their jungler is there to help them because they can't do anything otherwise. It's maybe obvious to us, but not as obvious to people watching.
If you're playing smart and you're constantly trying to improve, you'll build your game sense.
Even if a lot of pros feel like they don't get too much from solo queue, playing over and over and over, you'll learn patterns and you'll see patterns and you're just slowly picking up on things.
The best players in the world are experts at that. They can read a team fight, they can read a skirmish, they can figure out what to do, and if they can figure out faster their opponents, then they can come out ahead in a lot of situations.
I think Aframu has really good game sense. Like, he knows when to pressure his lane, but he also knows when to kind of leave his lane for a little bit and go roam and make plays around the map.
The flash comes in! Aframu hits a max rage binding! Feeding double is another kill.
Our bottom lane CLG, we gank all the time, so usually that's my responsibility to know when everything's gonna happen.
I could probably ask Meteos at any point in the game where the jungler is, and he'll give a huge, like, jungle timer and where the enemy jungler is off just one question.
I think everybody has it in them. It's just up for them to trust themselves.
You can never really perfect League of Legends. It's an evolving game and you have to constantly put time, hard work, and dedication into it.
And I think the craziest thing about this game sense is that everybody's still learning and everybody's still evolving to get to a better level.
And you have to keep it up on like every champion that you want to be able to use too. That's why people have to walk this line between small champion pool. Well, everybody but Faker has to walk this line between a smaller champion pool that you know really well and trying to have enough that you don't get banned out.
All right, well, let's see what the game sense is from LMQ Complexity as we get into the starting lineups. On the blue side, it will be LMQ. That's Ackerman in the top lane, No Name in the jungle, Xiaowei Zhao in mid, Vasiliad AD, and more on support.
And on the red side, it's Complexity with Westrice up top, Kez in the jungle, Prolly mid, Robert X Lease AD carry, and Bubba Dub support.
Complexity has yet to beat these guys. This is the one team that's kind of been their kryptonite as one of the top tier teams they haven't really been able to take a chunk out of yet. It would be huge. It would kind of keep Complexity knocking down those top teams, as we said, and really being a spoiler of all the winnings.
Yeah, now that LMQ are actually the first place team, it would send a huge message to the rest of the league if Complexity can actually take a game off of them.
And we have to mention, as we go into picks and bans here, LMQ will lose a ban for talking during a pause last week. So that is not something that can happen. Sometimes the players do forget. You'll get a kind of a warning first. Mm-hmm. And then, obviously, if you know they can't remember, they do lose a ban. So we're going to be seeing that as we start off picks and bans. And we'll see how it affects them with fast picks.
Yeah, now it's really interesting, actually, when one team only has two bans, because it does affect both teams and their strategy coming into the game. Working around only five bans, sometimes you'll just see a team just give up on banning all of the very strong champions and let a whole bunch of them through. They just open up the floodgates and try to grab as many as they can. But LMQ being on blue side means that if they did that, they would only grab one since they have first pick, and Complexity would be able to pick up two. See if Complexity try and work around that strategy, or if they just go with normal bans against LMQ. So far, pretty normal. Lulu extremely annoying up in the top lane, and it's such a flexible pick that it can be used in any of the lanes.
I feel like Gragas has a big place in this game.
Gragas definitely does.
Being taken away, being banned, I feel like Complexity is actually going to try and take this pick.
Yeah, the top lane is actually one of the lanes right now that has some of the biggest problems as far as champions are concerned. Nidalee and Gragas just are giant standouts. Above a lot of the other top laners. And one of them is going to be getting through here.
Just waiting a few more. What does it come out?
Oh, both
Lee
of them.
Sin.
Interesting.
This timeout on the selection, we'll see Complexity readied up. Or actually, LMQ's readied up with that loss of ban was the first one, rather. And so cover the Gragas once again.
We did.
Scary stuff.
Yeah, we did just play that clip of Ackerman absolutely running the game. Yeah. Versus CLG, but Nidalee being up, Nidalee's actually very good against Gragas. Now that she can transform into a cougar at level 1, she actually gets a lot of power really early on and can go very, very offensive in the lane, especially against someone who starts out melee here. No matter how much mobility Gragas has, Nidalee's gonna go poke him down early.
It's a big pickup for Robert X Lee, getting his Tristana, making sure that he can get to that late game with the team. Kaz can be a menace on Evelynn in the jungle.
That's actually a big point that we didn't even introduce again, because it's been banned out so many times against Complexity. The Tristana, this is by far one of Robert's favorite champions, and something that they have had a lot of success on in a lot of their games where they have upset the top teams. It's Robert on Tristana in the late game.
More. The big old smile on his face. No name's not
treat,
feeling
treat. The Brazilian finals are going on right now.
A huge crowd there. Awesome to see that show happening at the size that it is. After just a short amount of time, it was, I believe, IEM Sao Paulo. The crowd was one of the loudest I heard, but they're loud everywhere. Remember, All Stars.
Yeah,
our crowd. The NALCS crowd.
Yeah.
Kog'Maw locked in. So they say late game. You want some late game? We'll bring it to late game. Braum locked in for the safety on that. And Complexity will now teeter-totter on what they decide to pick up.
Yeah, and they combo this Kog'Maw with the Braum. So that lane is actually fairly strong. And it could go up against the Tristana lane, even though we've seen so many Tristana players just smashing their lane, shoving it in early, and using that great base damage of the explosive shot active to harass really early.
There's a silent cheer for Victor in the back and Jat.
Robert's been a really big proponent of the early static Shiv as well.
Yeah, getting quick Avarice, just getting gold, and then Shiv it out.
So I really like this Tristana for Complexity, because it does give them that power of shoving lanes really early and trying to get the early head start that
right.
they need.
Like we said, almost in every lane it's going to be necessary. Nidalee picked up with Morgana.
There it is.
Safety for the carry, or safety for a diver with Black Shield. No name on Rengar. Possible pickup.
Yeah, I want to go over these Complexity pickups, though, because they're very good answers to what LMQ took in their first and second rounds of picks. The Morgana is always pretty much the premier answer against Braum.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to go with something like Nami, who gets her entire ult negated by a regular spell from Braum. Morgana pretty much does the exact same thing to Braum, though, and can negate a lot of his CC with her black shield. And Nidalee, as we said, pretty much the only one who can handle Gragas in the top lane. We'll see. It looks like Complexity are going to take the standard lane phase here as well.
LMQ saying, yeah, we'll take that Gragas in the top lane again, but let's switch it up. Let's run Xerath for the first time in mid, and let's put No Name on Rengar for the first time in the jungle.
I like that.
At least in the LCS.
I do like that combo specifically against Complexity, because so much of Complexity's team in the late game revolves around Robert Exley on the Tristana. If you have Rengar and you have Xerath and you have Gragas, that's a lot of damage that you can get very far back into the Complexity line. No matter where Robert is, he's always going to have to be worrying about Rengar, Xerath ults coming in, even Kog'Maw ultimates. So they have a lot of long-range damage that they can do to take out Robert.
It's nicely combined.
Sort of circumvent the rest of the team and get around.
It's nicely combined with a little bit of that dive, too, after they get the poke that they want, that long-range damage. You have a Rengar and a Gragas body slamming into the fight.
So Complexity's answer is add more shields.
Yeah.
You get more damage onto Robert, then we will add more shields for him. Orianna plus Morgana here. Pretty good defensive combo to try and protect that Tristana. Nidalee as well, if she's actually with the rest of the team and not split pushing, can even add the heal and attack speed buff for Trist.
So LMQ coming into this game with loss of a ban in the beginning actually ends up picking two new champions we haven't seen come out of the LCS pools of both Xiaowei Xiao and No Name. So it'll be interesting to see actually how No Name, who likes to be aggressive and calls the shots, kind of has to play on a Rengar who more or less waits the six before he really makes those engagements. While the teams load onto the Rift, let's see how you've been voting. According to LOLesports.com, 76% of you think LMQ are going to be taking the W.
And as always, if you start to second guess your vote, then you can continue to update it by tweeting hashtag LMQWin or COLWin. And extra add in that at LOLesports just so we can see it.
So how will we feel Kez will be playing against that Rengar? Do we think he's going to find No Name? Do we think he'll try to kind of put a stick in his spokes in the beginning of this game and slow down the six?
I mean, that's always a good plan against Rengar, especially if you're Evelynn.
Yeah.
Because if you can find him at a camp and using his abilities on the camp, then it's very easy to bully him out of lane. Both of the junglers are probably going to be looking for those early wards, though. Kez's focus is always on vision. Mm-hmm. And Evelynn is actually one of the best champions for a jungler to get early deep vision, because she can walk right past your opponent's wards to place her own.
Right.
So that's why we see a lot of the best Evelynn's doing, investing in those vision wards and getting that down really early. Because if you get him down deep, you can see where Rengar's going to ult. And yes, Rengar ganks are really annoying post-6, but if you have the deep vision, you can see when he starts it off and just back off. And then he feels like garbage if he just wastes his entire ult.
It's always awesome to create those high-value, low-risk situations for yourself early in the game. That's what Complexity likes to try and get their advantage. And we'll see if LMQ allows that to happen here. LMQ, however, bringing out a pretty ferocious composition of their own. Looks like we got the AD carries looking for late game. We'll see how the lanes go. We have, remember, Kez, one of our junglers to watch coming in on this week.
Welcome to Summoner's Rift.
Thank you.
I don't think I've ever thanked her for that.
No.
Actually, she's every single game, she's so nice.
It's consistency.
Welcome back.
Well, yeah.
Line of scrimmage start here for both teams. Doesn't look like the early invade. Especially starting with those traps. The traps do a large amount of percentage health damage. And now as well. So it's always very nice to set those up very early as you get to regenerate early on. Ackerman on Gragas, though. Busted moves. Oh, no!
No! Composure.
It's just Braum playing with his puppy, okay? That's his pet. Little did you know, Kog'Maw is Braum's
Man's best
Loyal
friend.
Loyal dog.
Man's best friend.
Void dog.
It's a void puppy.
Puppy.
He's still young. Innocent. All right. Moving out to the buffs. Looks like it's going to be a standard start. Nothing wrong has happened just yet.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens. Biscuit starts. Spell Thief over to Relic. A little bit of gold generation on both sides, but we'll see if Bubba Dub tries to get himself aggressive. He's always trying to hit early Dark Bindings. At least start off Robert with a safer lane by putting the aggression down first.
Yeah, we also want to note that the deep ward on the blue buff there for Complexity. Ackerman back to his old ways because he doesn't want to get that early poke I talked about from Nidalee early. But yeah, the deep ward on that blue buff. Woo! Braum passive proc on both members here already. Talked about the power of Kog'Maw and Braum in lane. They get a nice early jump here. When Tristana's not able to push this Braum lane in, then that's a pretty big win for LMQ. Because Tristana has great pushing power, and that's one of Braum's weaknesses.
Ooh. If he can get her under the turret, it's going to be even harder for Robert X Lee. You can see him cautiously auto-attacking constantly, help keep that lane push.
Yeah, the early CS is always a little difficult with Tristana just because the explosive shot sometimes it puts you in a less than ideal situation with the minion health and you lose a couple, but it's even worse under the turret. We do have to mention, though, over there when we are taking a look at Kez, he was trying to get the small minions for that red buff in a line so his Q will hit all three at the same time. But he did fumble it a little bit.
He's making moves. These are the early wards we were talking about.
High value,
low risk. Can't be seen. Complexity, wow, with the vote. 62 to 38. That was a 70% vote, I believe, for LMQ coming into this game. See how that happens in mid lane. Probably working the mana bar very well here.
Yeah, it's actually something that's very important against Xerath. If you can use Orianna to zone Xerath from getting his auto attacks down, one of the biggest points of playing Xerath is making sure you get your auto attack every time your passive is up. Because if you don't, then you do have mana problems. So you'll see really strong Xerath players. They'll always find some way to get their passive proc off, auto attacking hopefully a champion, but minions work as well. Every time it's off cooldown. But if you can zone him like this, like Prowly's doing, then you can get him to have some mana problems early on.
All right, so we'll see what Xiaowei Xiao can continue to do here against Prowly in the mid lane. CS quite even. Prowly's not going to be seeing any ganks from Kez, so he has to keep that for himself. Kez is going to be keeping No Name down, or at least being as sure that he's as big as No Name when he tries to hop out of the jungle the first time. Still that 300 gold lead coming in for Complexity. Robert actually and Bubba Dub in a little bit better of a position here with the wards to stay in the face of Vasili, but these guys are still just having a blast, I guess, the bottom lane.
Yeah, the joke spam is the universal language. No matter what language you speak, everybody knows what Vasili's going for here. Vision from both junglers, heavy priority, as we said. They both have the pink wards, but No Name with the early sweeper start.
Oh, the flash in! Kez a little bit miscommunication there with Prowly. Looks like they will take a little bit of damage on the exit there. But Xiaowei Xiao still with the flash in mid now knows he's a bit safer because Kez blew his on that turn.
Yeah, and Rengar's doing a good job farming up so far. Already got the Madrids completed.
Whoa! Whoa! The burn! It burns! Oh, it's burning!
Oh!
Prowly with the fast first blood!
Prowly with the solo first blood. So rarely do we see solo plays being made, but Prowly comes up huge against Xiaowei Xiao, who right now is actually dropped down. He's got the second most CS at 10. Kez, though, coming in for another early action here from Complexity.
He's not done. See the flash in the top lane?
Yeah, Westrice not able to get that mark onto Ackerman to follow up.
That was big,
with
though.
With the long-range pounce.
Very nicely done. Kez blowing the flash in mid, able to blow a flash in the top lane. These are the small advantages that Complexity looks to grab. Can they get it now to Robert X Lee's lane? It's 42 to 39, so pretty even throughout that duo.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye on this mid lane here because if Prowly can get the large lead early over Xiaowei Xiao, he can definitely continue with that zoning we were talking about. And when you zone Xerath, you force him to use so much of his mana on the creeps just to get CS, plus you deny him the auto attacks for his passive. and it takes away so much of the mid lane power that's really important with controlling the early jungle, which both of these teams have been relying on. Deports, though, inside the
right
camp.
Right there, yep.
The best thing to do against Evelynn. Kez immediately going to get rid of that, though.
Yeah, quick sweeper out. Wow. Max range. The length of that stun coming in from Xerath, definitely dependent on the range of it.
Probably going to defend his pink ward here, though. Doesn't want to let Xiaowei Shao even get back to the minions. He's going to lose out some experience here, too, even though the range was increased.
Yeah.
If you go all the way around that corner, then you do lose out on the experience. Westfax takes out the pink ward really early. So that opens up Ackerman to more Evelynn ganks. That pink ward tax that we always talk about, hitting LMQ pretty hard early.
No name, no one. He can just kind of wait around in the jungle. That six very close for him, as we saw in his experience bar. He's just going through the jungle as he stacked up. Not stacked up, but grabbed that Madrid to get through it a little bit faster. 7.5 on the clock. Probably's first blood is really the only thing that hasn't been reacted to yet by Xiaowei Shao and team. Now a level 6 no name, we may see a buy before he tries to get a gank out here.
Yeah, the other thing you want to look for when you're expecting a Rengar gank is the full ferocity stacked up. Yeah, he's just going for the check there.
Just maybe kinda, but not really.
But it's already been taken. Yeah, you want to see Rengar stack up full ferocity in the jungle before he goes for his gank so he can get off two empowered abilities when he does go for it.
So now Complexity has a bit of an idea. Rengar's on the top side.
Yeah,
giving blue to Xiaowei Shao. They've pinged it out, so this is a bit more control here for Complexity. I don't think they're going to be able to use it, but that safety in lane allows them to maybe set something up here. We can see that. Probably just going back to farm wraiths, make things easy for themselves, and try to get a bigger lead. 72-66 there. It's not very often we see Xiaowei Shao down in CS coming up on the 10-minute mark.
Yeah, I mean, I guess there was a little bit of a gank from Kez early on to burn the heal. Uh-oh, Vasili gets hit.
That's a very nice Soul Shackle. He gets a double lockdown. Bubba puts himself in the right spot. Beautifully done. Akathy in surprise, no return on damage.
Great job by Complexity using that level 6 all in. Robert has been the hero when it comes to Complexity wins. Rengar mid, though.
Gonna be a good gank. Probably could have got himself caught out here. The shockwave goes down, but it's not gonna be enough to thwart.
Oh, Anther!
What a close in! Westrice already with the rotation from top lane. Complexity, 3 steps ahead.
Oh, Complexity coming up huge in the early game. That should be dragon for them because they simultaneously got kills bottom and mid. Huge, huge early swing of power here. Now this is a very dangerous gank. Should almost always be a guaranteed kill because Rengar can root his target for the easy long range stun from Xerath. But man, the collapse from Complexity was already in the works.
Great flash by Westrice and movement by the team to keep those kills going and both coming in. Now Dragon at 10 minutes over to them. We'll see if LMQ can answer with anything. Complexity getting that early lead, they already extended.
Man, the point I was gonna make about that level 6 all-in bottom from Complexity is that there's a huge boost in power for all-ins for Tristana and Morgana lane when they hit level 6, whereas Kog'Maw, his boost in power comes from harass that he'll be able to do in lane with his level 6. And so Complexity wastes no time. They jump on literally as soon as they get their level 6. To go for the burst and don't let Kog'Maw poke them down. Because once he gets that level 6, you heard Sneaky talk about it, it's so beastly in range.
Yeah.
The extra harass.
It's the ability to apply both Bio-Arcane and Living Artillery. But it's not going to be very good if it's going to be a Robert Exley at 18 first. He'll be able to just walk up and get a few shots in. 91-75 CS.
Rengar gank number 2.
The top lane, Westrice playing very safe. He already has the alert. He gets out safely. He should be all right. Wait, the ultimate. No, the explosive cast puts him back in range. He's got 300 and just about
he can
tech
jump
health.
In
he
can
get over the wall. The hit comes in. They get the Bola. It just misses. Actually, it hits him, but not on full charge to teleport out. One, two, three. Oh, my, wait a minute. Ackerman. What? Oh, man.
That's why when you check bushes, you always attack move the bush.
Just action.
Never just right click in the bush or else you won't attack your
even more action. What? Another back and forth.
Yeah.
Missed kills going down everywhere, but everybody's wanting more, which is cool. The action's not going to be stopping anytime soon.
Well, we're looking for all that early action between these two teams. As you said, Complexity have been a team that goes over and over back to this strong early game, and LMQ have shown so many times that they love playing aggressively in the early game. Great clash between these two. And it's the bottom team that's already looking like they have the advantage here. Complexity, though, so many times, even with early leads.
Yeah,
I like it. The games kind of drag out really, really long.
And these games are going to be all about damage, too, Kobe. Look at the top laners. Got Sheens coming out for both buys on first. It's going to be all-out war in every lane. I like it.
So Ackerman, I'll be very curious to see if he actually rushes the Lich Bane completion or if he goes with a second ability item in between Sheen and Lich Bane. Looks like he is rushing that Lich Bane that has become so common. I really do think that there's value in just going Sheen into the Zhonya's and then completing Lich Bane, because Lich Bane scales really well, but the upfront ability power from it, not the biggest gain.
So far in lane, with a little bit of help that West Rice has gotten, he has capitalized 1-0-1 for himself, as well as the roam mid. See if he can keep it up on Ackerman's Gragas. That has been a scary, scary thing in late game, and that's what both teams are looking for. We still have a long story to go here. 13 minutes in, 2,500 gold in favor of Complexity.
The thing is, we say Complexity, they always like these late games, and they found so many other wins in the super late game against top teams, but they shouldn't be looking for that. Right now, they have an early lead.
Of course.
And they should actually work on trying to snowball leads and close games out.
That's the
DP
jump.
Bottom.
He still has a flash. He can get over the wall. Actually, his flash is down. They're going to be going on Bubba Dub here. That's a very nice attack. Kez tries to come in. No Name's already on the outside. He sees
Whoa!
The Buster shot backwards, but they may be able to chomp down on Kez still. He goes down. No Name gets a piece of that as he's forced to walk out after the danger subsides. Minute and 50 onto Dragon.
Key there is coordinated aggression from LQ.
Yeah.
Teleport with Rengar gank both at the same time. So even though Kez is in the area, they aren't able to answer, and there's just a massacre of wards in the bottom mid. Bush.
Hopefully, West Rice can get this turret in the top lane. They only lost kills. They didn't lose Dragon. And he'll be able to create the pressure that might hold Ackerman in a good spot so that Complexity can start to put the pieces in order. Start grabbing buffs now, and that Dragon, the second one, if they could get it in their favor.
Yeah, even though that was great coordinated move from LMQ, they only got kills out of it. There wasn't there wasn't a tower taken down. There wasn't a dragon to pick up after this.
Teleport used.
So Robert jumps out of the way, and Bubba Dub uses the Black Shield on him at the same time. So that's unfortunate for Bubba Dub. He had nothing to save himself. But here's the follow-up. No Name, so dangerously close to going down. He also gets a heal from Vasily here, which saves his life long enough to get the kill for Dangerous Game as well.
Trying to look at the builds. Robert has actually changed his this time, not finishing the static shiv, puts a BF sword already within that damage, maybe to kind of trade off and max what Kog'Maw can put out of that level 6. 30 on Dragon, and Ackerman's going to be staying up here for the turret. He might be able to walk down after this unless he continues the pressure. Looks like he's going to be heading right for it.
He is able to answer the turret that it did cost him to go down bottom. However, that teleport's still going to be on cooldown, and West Rice just came back up. So now Nidalee can be in her element. Nidalee loves to split push. West Rice can stay up there, split push, and then use his teleport advantage to gain some sort of map pressure for Complexity as they posture around Dragon while Nidalee is split pushing. So Complexity will slowly get more and more map pressure if they're able to just occupy LMQ's time here and poke them and keep up the vision for long enough. Really, they're just trying to buy time for West Rice to slowly increase their lead. That means for LMQ, though, they need to force something.
Oh! He body slams him during rocket jump! What a hit from Ackerman, making plays around the map. And West Rice is going to be forced to use his teleport in what looks like the fight has already ended for Complexity. No Name wants to get back in. The Living Artillery, along with the shots from Xerath, not enough. It's just going to leave West Rice about 200 HP for a Primal Surge. He'll heal himself up and be safe with that sustain. Good fight from LMQ. They're posturing now for that Dragon again.
That's the tricky part. When you do have the split push advantage, you really need to rely on your four-man squad to not get caught. And LMQ do a great job of forcing it. They just have so many options to force the issue with Complexity. So much CC, and they use the Braum and Gragas to great effect there, earning themselves the dragon, even though Complexity had that teleport advantage.
And just when you think you can get away, you get two artillery fires falling on your head. Kog'Maw and Xerath. What a composition if you're trying to escape.
Yeah, that's the long range that we were talking about. So much long range damage from LMQ. They're running a team full of snipers. So it's pretty much the worst situation for Complexity. Yeah. For their four-man squad. They really have to be on top of the black shields and on top of their skill shot dodging abilities if they want to play this game with Nidalee.
So just looking around, taking stock of inventories. Cooldown Rengar, no name, puts up the Brutalizer. We'll see a little bit more of that coming into play against the Lizard of Kez. He's had that finish for a while, and he focuses on some magic resistance next. But these two in the top lane, you see the Triforce and the Lich Bane already completed as they start duking it out just a little bit.
And here it is, the aggression from West Price going to force Ackerman back. Ackerman can only get the advantage if he gets the jump on West Price. Gets into melee range. I really do like the change to Gragas where he has to actually put himself at risk now to do the large burst. He still has the large burst, but you actually have to get into melee
right.
range to use it. Maybe he needs a couple tweaks though. He's a little bit strong at the moment.
I don't know what you're saying, Kobe.
Maybe the AoE aspect of it needs to be taken down a notch. We'll see though. Bounce team is on it, I'm sure.
LMQ soaking up resources on their side of the map. It doesn't look like they have any pressure for Complexity at this moment. No wards either. Everything's on their side. As they are down 2,000 gold, they haven't really been the one to make the offensive move. That mid lane aggression was kind of just the back and forth of the poke they're able to bring to the table, and then they got the advantage. You see Complexity still trying to get in their jungle and still trying to make advantages.
Trying to keep that deep vision down. Bumped
yep.
Up does get it in the bush, but immediately cleared out by LMQ. They've got three sweepers now and already the scrying orb as well for Xiao and Xiao. I like the pickup here. Usually it's an AD carry to get it, but Xerath can use it as well to go
yeah.
for those snipes. If someone gets into the fog of war and thinks they're safe, we may see Xiao and Xiao with one of those long range surprise artillery kills.
I'm going to see. We've seen some good snipes and we've seen some. Maybe his eyes were closed. Snipes.
Ah, here goes the EU blue buff again.
To the NA LCS. Pretty good so far coming from Xiao Wei Xiao. Doesn't have to use the orb on that one, and it's
that
down.
That definitely left something to be desired there. Because, as we said, Complexity have a lot of shields to use.
That's true.
So, timing
has got to be remembered.
Not
you only have
ideal.
A small window. It's just the all out battle now, Kobe. Nobody wants to go anywhere. It's the mid turret next, it appears.
All right, let's see here, because there is no teleport for West Rice, so
yeah.
they don't really have that option. Even if they wanted to go back to that style and think that they have a better chance of dodging this time, they don't have the teleport. And it's very risky for West Rice to be on his own. Since Vasily's down here, though, he knows his team will not be collapsed on. And Vasily, by the way, on that Kog'Maw, going with the Blade of the Rune King first actually does help him if he was in the situation where he had to 1v1 with West Rice to give him that extra disengage since Nidalee will be closing the gap.
Nice shots coming in. Look at the CS here. 201 to 190 in that mid lane right on the backside bubbed up. Looks like he got caught up on some minions. They may have gone for a dark binding there, but the rest of the team just putting and applying a bit more pressure. Item threshold for the 80 carries, just about an Infinity Edge here for Robert X Lee. Just about a static Shiv, possibly, or that Phantom Dancer coming up for Vasily.
All right, let's see if Vasily can bait in West Rice and then have a no-name gank come in. West Rice, that always has to be in the back of his mind. Anytime there is a Rengar on the team, it makes a split pusher's job much, much more difficult.
Scary.
This deep ward, though, might... Oh, no name gets right around the vision of that ward. Sneaky, sneaky no name. They are doing a really good job of setting up this bait. Vasily looks juicy for West Rice, but he's not taking the bait. West Rice has become such... He's been for a very, very long time, years and years, known as one of the most aggressive top laners, and he would just always split push and not really even care about ganks. He'd just deal with the gank when it showed up, and he'd try and outplay them. Mm-hmm. However, in recent times, he's been playing much, much more safe, and he's been much, much more cautious. And it's really paid off for Complexity. It's turned the team really around, I think.
It's a hard thing to do. Remember him on Akali and whatnot. Everything he played kind of put him in that aggressive mentality. So.
And he knows, yes, I have the power. I can, I know I can take this Kog'Maw, but it's not worth the risk
of
the Rengar counter gank.
Good
so
patience.
He wastes a lot of no-name's time there.
2-1 only in turrets. With all the commotion we've had in the game, it's really just been each other's throats instead of the structures. The Zhonya's will be second coming in for Ackerman. He's in the top lane without any pressure right now. He's just having a ball. And he gets another wave to the turret. Top turret's going to be going down for him. Lichbane assisting in that. We'll see if he can keep it rolling. He is not getting any pressure from what's a teleport to come in from Westrice. Stuck in the bottom lane from Vasili before he gets away. Great pressure in. LMQ now is getting themselves a lead on this one. He's now on the inhibitor turrets.
Yeah, let's see what's their answer for this split pushing Gragas, because he's got a Lichbane. He's going to take that inhibitor turret down very quick. Westrice is recalling right now, but there is going to be a pretty big chunk out of that top side.
Looks like Westrice will get there in time. Yeah, it's not going to be too much damage. That will heal up, but Ackerman now still teleport up. Doesn't look like they'll be able to get there first, but Dragon is definitely a possibility here, and the game could go in their favor after this. Big fight without Westrice could be huge.
Yeah, nobody wants to get in a 5 versus 4 situation in a game that's this close. There's so much damage on both games. Anyone out of position will go down really quickly. And Complexity don't even want to fight this one because they don't have Westrice near. It's the pick potential for both of these teams is actually quite large.
LMQ feels like they can take a little bit of ground, and they
Man,
do.
Man, what the? Complexity completely out of sorts here. They just give up two objectives.
And mid.
Back to back.
Oh, yeah, right. That's huge. Dragon and two turrets now going in the favor of LMQ. Complexity seems to have been snoozing for a little bit there. Way too complacent with the lead that they had, and they have been taken by storm. Turrets are tied up. Gold is just about the same, and Kez looking to make a play, and this is desperation for Complexity now.
Complexity, what they're looking for is the Evelynn flank into the Orianna Shockwave, but LMQ are very well aware that that is the only really engage from Complexity, their only option. So they're warding up the sides. They have one defensive pink ward over on the Baron side, so they know he's not going to come from that side. But you can see they all want to spread out. All that LMQ really need to do is make sure they don't clump up Xiaoyi Xiao and Vasili specifically. Do not want to stand together for that Evelynn and Ori combo.
Very interesting.
Kez keeps
game.
Looking for it, though. I have to say, even though LMQ have evened up the gold, they haven't gone back to buy after that dragon and that mid turret, so they might want to go purchase before they actually pick the fight. Because, yeah, they evened up the gold. Oh, actually. Probably sitting on 2,400 gold right now.
And Bubba Dub goes down. He's sitting on 1,100. Kez goes down as well. LMQ dances this one out until they get the kills and the fight that they want. Ackerman throws that one just a little bit short.
Yeah, how did that pick from the side even? That was a Rengar gank, I guess. No name. There's no other way he would have just caught Bubba Dub blind like that. Man, takes him down so quickly. That support Morgana has no armor and very little health. Very easy for a damage Rengar to take out since he does have Brutalizer at least.
Something that LMQ is really good at capitalizing on.
Let's take a look. Oh, Lord sets it up into the...
Bye-bye.
No chance. And then he's in the bush as well, so they get the jump onto Kez. Complexity, for the last maybe 5 minutes, just look out of sorts.
Yeah.
They kind of lost their way here. They didn't have a game plan. In this around this 20-minute mark, they gave up two objectives, and then they just kind of milled around in the mid lane until they got picked off. Not a clear plan for them as far as the mid game goes, and that's what we've seen so many times from them. Their early game, methodical. It looks great. You know, they get the side kills, they get the picks, they get the dragon control, and they seem to come out with these really early leads a lot. But then they always lose it in the mid game, and the game just ends up going extremely long, and they can't they can't really finish or capitalize on any sort of early lead that they've gotten. We'll see, though. They do have Tristana with a two-item power spike here. Shiv plus Infinity Edge now completed.
Yep, a little bit of her own sustain. Ackerman's been doing a good job at cleaning back up, but finally get these guys back to a split push, if they can even make it happen. Looking for Westrice here, coming out of the base. He still has teleport up. LMQ feels like they are in the driver's seat now, and rightfully so. They made such a move recently on Complexity. Usually Complexity is the one, like we said, once they get that advantage, the other team kind of puts themselves in a pressure situation. Robert will pick up a few more kills at a dragon, but LMQ is now avoiding Complexity.
Oh, here comes the flank, though. They're looking for it once again. The four-man squad's got to worry. Ackerman, see, LMQ do a good job. They call him right up. They can sense that Kez is coming around the side. They call Ackerman over. This will be a 4v5, actually. Complexity start off the 4v5.
There's the Blade of the Rune King. He still has to use it. Kez gets taken down immediately. Vasily with the fast fingers and the help of his teammates on that. Bubbadub's going to be going down on this. And LMQ, like I said, they are avoiding Complexity until Complexity steps up to the fight. And then they use all of this to take down the fight. Ackerman still in range, gets the Q slow, and they are going to get another kill over to Vasily. What a great way to fight from LMQ.
Well, it was just the difference in communication between the two teams. Complexity, Westrice was down bottom and Ackerman left the lane, but he didn't make the call. And Complexity engaged at 4v5. Ackerman very quick on that Gragas to make his way all the way up mid. And so Ackerman there for the beginning of the fight while Westrice had to run and follow made a huge difference.
28-minute Baron. First place LMQ showing why high caliber amount of play. And they're just waiting. They all group mid, and when they start fighting, they lay down the wards to win the fight. And the rest of it is history.
Yeah, I mean, you do get Westrice coming in eventually, but Ackerman was there for the beginning. Evelyn saw Kog'Maw. There's a reason that people are picking Kog'Maw so often now. Uh-oh, let's see the flash. Was gonna hit. Kog'Maw, even if people like Twitch or Evelyn open up on Kog'Maw, he deals so much damage if you stand there right next to him and give him a free Q and E to land on you, that he can just stand toe-to-toe with a lot of these quote-unquote assassins that come up to him invisible. And he does not run away, especially with this Blade of the Ruined King build where he's got the extra passive that he can activate when somebody pops out on him.
Yeah. A lot of people don't take into consideration the, not that it would be leveled up too much yet, but that passive Q speed definitely takes control in a fight. You already stack Static Shift and Blade on
The shred from the active cannot be overstated. It is huge in those 1v1 situations.
He's back in. Looks like he's got some gold to spend, possibly a lot closer to an Infinity Edge or that after a huge kill lead coming in. And that is the Infinity Edge for Kog'Maw. He spikes over Robert Exley quite hard here, but we'll see what they have as they go back. See it, haunting guys for Prolly here in the Orianna build. Very interesting.
Yeah, going for that flat spell penetration because he's really looking for the shockwaves onto priority targets. So if he gets the carries, either Gragas, Xerath, or Kog'Maw, flat penetration, really, really effective. And he's just banking a lot on the fact that he can get a good shockwave on the priority targets that don't have magic resist. Because that's what Complexity are going to need to turn this game around, honestly. They are in a very, very tough spot.
Yeah.
It would have to be a really, really good shockwave to turn the game around for them.
Well, they're really trying to ward this up, Kobe. They have a lot of the vision necessary to make the moves, but LMQ is just so fast to react every time. It makes it look like there's no possible entry.
Yeah, LMQ, they haven't spent a lot of money on wards, but look at their hyper carries here. The Kog'Maw's got an extra item over Tristana right now. A whole Blade of the Rune King lead is massive for LMQ. And the little bit of vision that they do have is covering pretty much everything that they actually need right now. Since Baron's off the map, Dragon's off the map, they don't really have to worry about controlling anything besides blue buff. If they keep that away from Orianna, it allows them to shove in on the turrets. Probably is already wearing it though, so they'll have to wait for a respawn.
See how far back Complexity stands from that turret. It's really where LMQ's composition excels once they get up to that point.
Well, they can't also fight without Robert, definitely. So this is definitely a trade of turrets that they're banking on here. They're hoping that they can wave clear with that Ori, but it hasn't been enough.
Yeah. Well, Robert doesn't have any attention just yet. They don't have vision on Ackerman backing, so he may feel a bit scared in that spot. He will see Ackerman in a second.
Robert keeps pushing here.
Yep.
Whew. He knows what happened to Double Lift.
Ackerman just throws behind.
I've seen this before. Ackerman doesn't want to give up either. Gragas could take this chase.
Oh, man.
Oh!
What?
What a throw! Ackerman on the Gragas has been just destroying AD carries left and right. And that was yet another example where he gets to use the teleport to join the team after he gets a kill. Should be a huge win for LMQ here.
Yeah, losing your AD carry at that point in the game during the split push, not a good situation here for Complexity, and they're going to be losing an inhibitor right away. Last shot from Vasily comes in, and that's going to be 32 on the clock for the first inhibitor.
Yeah, and you can see in that gold graph the huge, huge difference in the mid game there, where Complexity kind of stopped making the decisive calls, and LMQ just took several uncontested objectives. We'll see if this flank works out, though. Evelyn in the back. They've got no power left.
Bro, there's too much to dodge. He has to dive into death in one way or another. Kez tries to get himself out. He flashes. Definitely a suicide mission. Bubbadub's now focused as the kill. LMQ has taken the inhibitor first time and every time they've played Complexity, and it's only been a matter of 3 minutes after for them to win the game. They'll repeat history once again. They'll drop top and hit. And they'll be going for the Nexus turrets. Quadra kill for the Kog'Maw.
And Vasily just sits in those double turrets after his quadra kill goes down. But it will be a victory for LMQ, and well-deserved.
Absolutely.
Great push on the mid-game there.
Definitely something for Complexity to go back and look. The falter of the mid-game is LMQ made sure to take advantage of that. They run it to 33 minutes, 15-7, and a 12,000 gold lead at the end from almost nothing. LMQ takes down Complexity in our first game of the week. I think that's one of the first times we've seen a team kind of recoup and figure out what Complexity is doing. How are they just taking our lanes down? But then again, we saw the early game not being a game of objectives. It was a game of champions. And LMQ, they know how to play the champion game. They'll dive you, they'll poke you, they'll kill you. And then they take a mile after getting that inch. They were able to turn that spark on after just one of those mid fights and really take control of the game.
Yeah, really well executed. And we will probably never see Ackerman get Gragas again.
No.
Especially in his current
form. That'd be crazy. Even with a lost ban.
Even with Nidalee laning against him, Westside's not able to put pressure on Gragas. And
an early kill on him, or an early flash blown and then attack. Yeah.
Yeah, even with an Evelyn jungle and a Nidalee top lane.
Not a kill.
Almost the most pressure that you could have in that top lane in a 1v1 matchup. Definitely not going to want to be giving away Gragas any longer.
Very strong play from Complexity in the early game when they do just have the most power. Rotations from Westrice in the top lane. His individual play in general, you know, has been getting a lot better. But at one point when they do kind of get put under the wave and then they just keep getting spun around and spun around, they can never get back to the surface after that. And LMQ made sure to keep him down.
Yeah, LMQ definitely proved that they deserve this number one spot, and they're going to hold on to it, regardless of who management is. Players are going to take care of their business.
So like you said, that Gragas, built in so many different ways that we've seen now. Now a Lichbane rush coming in from Ackerman. He wanted the power. He wanted to be able to create split push opportunities.
Well, yeah, that's what we saw last time. He showcased this full AP Gragas.
Wild.
It's really fun to watch when he does get those 1v1s with AD carries, which he keeps finding.
And we got a deja vu moment in the bottom lane again. Mm-hmm. It's kind of crazy that you always see that consistent play from one person, but yet a team would still allow them to get that champion. Maybe it was just a few times. Maybe it was that any given Sunday moment. But with the consistency we see from LMQ, we read the stats off in the beginning. Kills, assists, they hold the accolades on that team for having some of the highest. They're not a team to be messed with or given the champions they feel comfortable on. So right now we're going to throw it over to the guys at the analyst desk to break down LMQ's win.
Thanks, Riv. We want to welcome Aiden Zyrene Moon to the desk, as usual now, to help us break down that LMQ win. Now, I want to touch on a couple things real quick at the beginning here. The first being Complexity got out to a really, really quick early lead. But then I want to touch on LMQ dismantling that lead. So, Zyrene?
Yeah, it started off with Complexity getting some nice picks and rotations around the map. It's probably Kez's shot calling there. But then when it came into the late game, at the start, we had all those stats. Ackerman, number one in kills for top laner. Then we have Moore, number one in assists. When the team groups up for LMQ, they win the team fights pretty much just flat out. Every time they grouped up, they got a positive lead. They took objectives off of it. And that's a shot calling of No Name coming in and being more objective team fight prowess focused with their mechanics. And that's way different than Complexity style, where they're picking off and trying to get a lead, and then they didn't push it. They kind of let up the pressure. There was a dragon where Prawly was out of mana. They didn't set up for it with wards appropriately, and they just had to back off.
Yeah, it was really interesting because Complexity, as you mentioned, did do really well early game, and that is just individual skill straight up. They got counterpicks there. They got Nidalee. Again, she is the best top lane bully right now, and Rest Price was winning that lane. In the bot lane, you had the Morgana into Braum counterpick, and you're going to win the 2-on-2 when that happens, and this is what happened. These are things that you expect here from Complexity. We also had probably the wild card show up as an ace instead of a deuce there, so he actually did really well and also got the extra kill in the mid lane, and these are things that Complexity can oftentimes rely on, and that's good. The problem is it felt like Kez didn't know what to do once they were up against some real wave clear. Early game lead, couple thousand gold, and then he suddenly couldn't deal with Gragas split push. He suddenly couldn't deal with doing dragon timers right, or when the Tristana siege isn't working anymore, he's out of plans, and his turrets are suddenly falling over. And that's a really big problem they need to fix.
Well, so how do you fix that? You know, you understand what the problem is, but you've picked a comp that seemingly has a lot of counters, as you point out. Where's the fix?
You basically, I mean, it really depends on how you want to do it, right? A team can simply come in and say, we're going to keep playing the same type of strategies like LMQ does, always aggressive teams, and say, we're going to figure out how to play aggressive and either tower dive you or split push better against this. Alternatively, Kez needs to sort of come up with a new strategy instead, right? You look at other teams, look at teams better than you, guys like Samsung Blue, you know, etc., all these great Korean teams out there, and say, okay, this is how these guys are adapting to the problems. These are how these guys fix these issues. And you learn them, right? It's Kez's job to learn, how do I move my team around late game? Letting Gragas push two turrets top lane and recalling late is not a play you're supposed to make.
Yeah, it's pressure through map domination and map control. They just completely let up. They had CS leads all across the board in the early game throughout the lanes. They got a solo kill in the mid lane. They didn't leverage these little bits and turn them into a big crowbar to just pry the game open. They kind of just got very relaxed. And that's very Complexity-like. We've seen it. They have these really long games for a reason most of the time, because when they do get a lead, they don't know how to close it out. It has to be just ward their jungle, ward it deep, get objectives warded up so you can just keep snowballing your gold. They gave up dragons, like I said, over and over again, and it's just pressure. Just pressure, pressure, pressure.
Yeah, it's like they get complacent when they have a lead, and they're willing to let the game move into that. They're like, hey, this early lead will allow us to take it late, as opposed to using that early lead to actually close out the game.
Yeah, and that's why I think Complexity are actually 0-4 against LMQ now, whereas they're beating some of the other top teams. Is LMQ or a team that will never sit there and be lax? And as you exactly mentioned, I think it's exactly right. Complexity, they're so good individually, they can get the early lead, and they say, well, we'll just snowball somehow, it'll just happen. But LMQ are so good at finding those cracks and saying, well, there's a kill, there's a pick, there's a dragon, game over.
All right, well, let's take a look at our first replay. It's about 27 minutes in. It's where LMQ kind of makes a big push, gets a 3-for-0, and then takes Baron off of this. Zyrene, if you could walk me through this.
All right, well, what ends up happening here is we see them just come up on the side. Boom, Kez, he's trying to flank. The command protect actually gets stunted by the unbreakable of Braum, so the shockwave actually goes off, but it doesn't go off cooldown because probably went too far to reposition the ball, and then didn't actually get his ultimate off. They end up picking up Robert here, and that transitions, I mean, sorry, Bubba Dub, and they get them very low, and that transitions into them getting a Baron pretty easily because of the flank. Kez, he stuck to that battle plan of we're going to continue to flank them. He didn't adjust mid-strategy, and we see that later on in the game too, where he keeps trying to go for these flanks and not adjusting his battle tactics.
Yeah, I just felt like Kez was sort of trying to find what was going to work mid-game. He's like building the plane mid-flight, sort of, because he realizes, oh, shoot, this siege isn't working. Okay, let's try to find a flank that's going to work. But the team's not on the same page yet. Prawly's out of range. Kez gets this beautiful flank. He gets a one-on-one against the Kog'Maw, and that's like, oh my god, Braum's not there, and I found Kog. This is the holy grail for every jungler ever. But Prawly's not there to shockwave him. And when he shows up, Braum blocks it, right? Like, the right ideas are there, but they're there 5 minutes late every time for Kez.
So is this lack of preparation then on Complexity side by saying, hey, presupposing we do get that early lead, here's the steps we're going to need to follow to dismantle this team?
It's one of the issues of a newer team is we've heard so many players say scrims just are different than actual LCS matches. Players are so much more risk-averse, they're so much more reserved, you just don't get that type of practice. And Complexity are one of the new teams in the LCS. They have less of these really close, tense games where no one's making mistakes. And normally, if you're going to play a slow reserved, we'll capitalize on you style. That works in scrims, because people are loose and they'll screw up. And here, you're seeing LMQ be very smart about their movements, very direct when they split push, but they're grouped up otherwise, and suddenly, there's no random picks to be had, and they don't know how to force it in anymore.
I kind of don't buy that excuse, though, because LMQ have been in the LCS the same duration of Complexity, and they actually have some veterans there with Prawly, who's been on the stage before. Like, I kind of feel like it's just a play style type of thing. LMQ, we talked about it. Vasili has number one AD carry CS. Xiaowei, I believe he's number two in 10, and CS at 10. These guys, they get really early leads, then they team fight, and they win the fights off of that. When they get behind, their team fights are a little sloppier, because they don't have that advantage. Complexity, we're in a spot where if they started team fighting and they team fought correctly, then they would be able to come out on top and then just keep snowballing the lead. It's just those little things where it's like, when do we group up? How do we group up? What do we put vision on? And what do we deny them vision of and make a pick?
Okay. Well, I'm curious because, too, there's veterans on both teams. You've got Ackerman on LMQ, right? So we do have that veteran presence, and I guess one of the questions would be then if Prawly is doing what he needs to do as the veteran to kind of teach them these lessons, right?
Yep.
Earlier in the split and say, hey, this is how we're going to have to perform in competition. Anyway, it's time to get into the last replay here where Kog'Maw actually picks up a quadra kill at the end of the game. So Freak, if you don't mind walking us through the final replay of the game.
Sure. So at this point, it's LMQ using their lead properly. They'd gotten Baron recently, and they're basically just ahead, and so sieging is fairly easy. They push on in, and the thing is, Vasili just feels very confident as long as they're aware of where the Evelynn flank could be coming from. Unfortunately, he doesn't see it come in, but there's just no follow-up. Look how far away Prawly is, right? There's no one to really punish the back line. Everyone just kind of falls over, and at this point, you just have a gold lead, and unless you can stack crowd control on your opposition, and you don't have very much aside from Shockwave, there's just not much to do there. And so it's actually pretty easy to walk those fights in. And actually to talk about the point about playing aggressively and the two teams being new as well is if your default strategy is aggressive, I think it's easier to play with less synergy than something more relaxed and reserved. I think it's easier to be like, well, we've only been together for 6 months. But if everyone always knows, oh, always go in and Ackerman split pushes, that's a pretty easy style to continue to play and to understand intuitively compared to a disengaged one where you've got to always be paranoid about where people are.
And a big thing about that is you all have to be on the same page as soon as you see a misstep, because one person will be like, he took 2 steps forward, that's a misstep. And other people will be like, no, that's not enough for me. We'll wait for another opportunity.
Right.
So it becomes a split call.
Exactly.
All right, well, one final point. With that win, C9, CLG, and TSM all actually punched their tickets into the postseason. So what are those teams now, what are they thinking, right? Because that's a little bit of weight off their shoulders going into these final games of the season. Is we don't really care what happens. Let's experiment, or let's take the wins and build momentum.
Oh, it's absolutely not a time to be lax right now, because these guys are still, they've all got 5 to 6 games left in the season, and they're 2.5 games or 3.5 games behind LMQ. And a first round bye is really important because all the playoff teams are super good, and we're seeing that from Curse, Dignitas, and the guys who are locked in the playoffs. So skipping quarterfinal, huge deal.
Yeah, and I can't speak for their mentality, but you definitely can't get relaxed here. You have to be forward-looking, forward-thinking. Playoffs, anything can happen. We could have an upset. We could have one of the bottom teams become the number one team. There's a lot that can happen in a bracket. So when you come into this, you just research the teams. You continue doing what you're doing if you're LMQ, and you just try to bring it home.
Definitely scrambling for that second seed, at least for that first round bye, is very important for these teams. Well, thank you guys so much for all the input, as always. We've got to take a quick broadcaster cooldown. When we come back, we'll jump into the action with TSM versus Evil Geniuses. Stay tuned. War.
What is it good for?
Absolutely nothing.
The shockwave goes down, but it's not going to be enough to thwart.
Oh, and there!
What a close in! Westbrite's already with the rotation from top lane. Complexity, 3 steps ahead. There's the Blade of the Rune King. He still has to use it. Kez gets taken down immediately. Vasili with the fast fingers and the help of his teammates on that. Kez tries to get himself out. He flashes. Definitely a suicide mission. Bump it up's now focused as the kill.